I beg your pardon. Sorry, I was on mute. So I said, thank you very much, dear Pitambar Prabhu, for giving me this opportunity to be with all of you and to serve all of you today. We'll get started with Mangalacharan prayers. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamhayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Namaum Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhaktivedanta Swamin Iti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Maha Vadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaura Tuse Namaha He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna dear devotees thank you very much for joining this evening for our discussion on on Shri Bhagavad Gita. And today we will be discussing the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita entitled Transcendental Knowledge. And we will be studying one verse, verse number 20. So let me share my screen so everyone can see the verse. So I hope, are you able to see the screen or no?
Not yet.
Okay, my screen sharing is not working, so I will not be able to share the screen, but that's okay. I will read the verse.
I already made you co-host. You will be able to definitely share the screen.
Prabhu, actually, there is some problem with my computer because of which somehow I'm not able to share. Okay. But that's all right. I will read. Just everyone can listen. So this, or those who can pull it up, if you have the Bhagavad Gita or on your smartphones, you can pull it up on your computer. This is Bhagavad Gita as it is. Transcendental Knowledge, the fourth chapter, and we'll be studying verse number 20th. Lord Krishna is explaining to his dear friend and disciple Arjun transcendental knowledge. So dear devotees, there are two types of knowledge. There is Jadagyan and there is Divya Gyan. Jada Gyan is knowledge of this material world. It includes everything. Medical science, engineering science, law, MBA, you name it. Mathematics, sociology, history, geography, everything. Astronomy. It is all grammar, language. Everything comes under the umbrella of Jada Gyan. It is knowledge about this mundane world, this material world. It is essential for surviving in this world, for living in this world, but it is temporary knowledge. It is called Jada Gyan, or knowledge of the mundane world. We may be PhDs, we may have master's degree, but it all comes under mundane knowledge. The second category of knowledge is called Divya Gyan. Divya Gyan means transcendental knowledge, divine knowledge. This knowledge is perfect knowledge. For example, I am a medical doctor. We study the medical textbooks, medical journals, but the knowledge is constantly being updated. Why? Because the medical knowledge that we have is not perfect. For example, when COVID-19 pandemic broke out, as medical professionals, we did not know how to treat it. So initially, we just had no idea. We were just giving the patients supportive care. If the oxygen level is dropping, provide oxygen to the patient. If the patient is wheezing, give them some nebulization treatment. If the patient is having fever, give the patient some medicine to control the fever. So we did not know how to treat. So we were just giving supportive care. With some medical studies, with some research, with some experience, then we realized that dexamethasone or steroids, they have an important role to play in COVID-19, especially when the patients get really sick and are requiring supplemental oxygen. So then steroids were tried. Then so many different medicines were tried. Some proved to be effective, some proved to be not effective. So many vaccines were developed. Some proved to be effective, some not so effective. Some had some side effects, which we realized with time. So we keep updating our knowledge. Same holds true for engineering. We had an iPhone 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I think we have iPhone 10. Why so? Why not manufacture iPhone 10 directly? Because the knowledge was not so much updated. The knowledge had not been refined. As we develop and refine our knowledge, things get better and better. This is called the ascending process. Through experimentation, through research, through studies, through experience, we try to make things better and better. This is the ascending process, and it involves Jada Gyan, mundane knowledge. Mundane knowledge is ascending process, the process of experimenting, researching, and trying to make things better and better. And things may get better and better, but they will never get perfect. Hare Krishna. Does anyone have any doubt about this? Does anyone think that medical science or engineering science or any branch of mundane knowledge can attain perfection? You can unmute or you can raise your hand. If you think we can attain perfection through research, through experimentation, please raise your hand. It is not possible. It is not possible to attain perfection. For example, let's take transportation. We read in our history books that the modes of transportation in the bygone years were horse carriage or horseback or ox cart, or people would just travel by foot. You see, then bicycles were invented and automobiles were invented, and initially they were very crude. I remember in school we studied the wheel was invented, but tire was not invented, the tire made of rubber. So the bicycles that were used in the initial years when they were invented were nicknamed bone rattlers. because when they would go on the road, they would rattle so much because there was no rubber tire. So they were called bone rattlers. Then rubber tires were invented and then it got smoother. The rides became more comfortable. So this is Jadagyan, the process of ascending knowledge. We experiment, we research, we experience, we try to make things better, and we climb up. We climb up, ascending process. We try to make things better. We can make them better, but we cannot make them best. We cannot make them perfect ever. So now we have motorcycles and we have four-wheel cars and we have air-conditioned cars and we have all-wheel drive cars. We have cruise control cars. Then we have adaptive cruise control. We just put them on adaptive cruise control and it automatically adjusts the speeds. It can even come to a complete stop if there is some obstacle. And then we have completely automatic driving cars now. Hare Krishna. It keeps getting better. But is it perfect? No. Accidents still happen. Even if there is not a single accident, which is not the case. In fact, it is very disheartening to know that more people die in road accidents than all the wars, including World War I, World War II, all wars, all terrorist attacks combined. In my state of Georgia, I live in the state of Georgia, every year on an average, 1,200 people die just from road accidents in the state of Georgia, and there are 50 states in America, and America is just one country. Hare Krishna. Just process that. Every year, 1,200 civilians die in road accidents in the state of Georgia. And we have some of the safest cars, some of the best roads, some of the most rigorous process in issuing driver's license, but still accidents happen because transportation has not reached perfection. Even if we attain perfection and there are zero accidents, no one dies ever in a road traffic accident, still it is not perfect. Why? Because to make the rubber tires, we need to cut trees. Hare Krishna. To get the fuel, we have to create pollution. And when the car runs on the roads, it creates a lot of pollution. And this pollution leads to so many health problems like asthma, lung cancer, and so many other diseases. This is just one example. Same thing with communication. Initially, communication was through writing letters and sending some servants on horseback to deliver the letter. Then they tried pigeons, birds, kabutar, ja, 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 kabutar, ja. You know, they tried with pigeons. Then they developed a mail system where you take a proper envelope, you put a stamp on it, you have to pay for that stamp, you write the address, and you put it in a proper authorized mailbox and it will reach. Then we have, instead of, that is called snail mail because it takes forever. Then we have privatization, private companies like FedEx and UPS, and they can deliver overnight. But still it's snail mail. It's very expensive and it takes a day or two. Then there is email. Email is instant. Within seconds, you can send a message across the world through internet. And now we have WhatsApp and Facebook and Zoom, where we can communicate in real time. Not just text messages, typed emails, but in person, as if you're sitting. I can see Lakshmi Mataji as if she's sitting right in front of me. So this is very wonderful. I can even see the lamp behind her, the wall behind her, the window next to her. I can see her. I can see everything. So this is as good as it gets. But then we have people getting addicted to iPhones, getting addicted to Facebook, doing this and then getting neck pain. I see it all the time. And then being on the computer all day and getting shoulder pains. So is communication perfect? No. And then there is eye strain and there are migraine headaches. And there's always fear of radiation from these phones. These are relatively new things, new inventions. It became commonly used in 2000, 2001. So we don't really know the long-term effects. certainly there are some effects like headache and migraines and eye strain. So communication is not perfect. So this is called Jada Gyan. It has to be updated and it is not perfect. Then there is Divya Gyan. Divya Gyan means transcendental knowledge, and that is the title of chapter number 4, which we are studying together. It is called transcendental knowledge, Divya Gyan. This knowledge is perfect. Bhagavad Gita as it is. It was spoken millions of years ago at the beginning of creation by Lord Krishna to Sri Vivaswan, who is the sun god. Same Bhagavad Gita was spoken 5,000 years ago to Arjun on the battlefield of Kurukshetra by Lord Krishna. And that same Bhagavad Gita as it is given to us by our founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada. Does this Bhagavad Gita need to be edited or updated? 2021 version of Bhagavad Gita, like our medical textbooks, Harrison's Principles of Medicine, 2004, textbook of medicine, 2008, in 4 years, completely revised, updated. No, for Bhagavad Gita, what Krishna spoke millions of years ago, thousands of years ago, and today, in the year 2021, is the exact same Bhagavad Gita. No need to modify it, no need to update it, no need to edit it. Why? Because this is not like Jada Gyan. This is Divya Gyan. This is transcendental knowledge. And this is the descending process. Hare Krishna. Descending process. Ascending process is a process of experimentation, experience, updates, iOS updates, for example. That is ascending process. Descending process is when a perfect source gives perfect knowledge. Perfect source gives perfect knowledge. That is the descending process. From someone who is superior to us, we are receiving the knowledge. That is the descending process. And that is transcendental knowledge, divine knowledge, perfect knowledge. Will never be edited, will never have to be updated. It is perfect eternally. Hare Krishna. So which knowledge is better, my dear friends? Jada Gyan or mundane knowledge is imperfect. And it deals with temporary subject matters. Temporary subject matters. Someone may study, for example, the technology of a black and white TV. 20 years later, that technology is outdated. It is no longer used. Now we have not only color television technology, but we have flat screen, LCD, plasma screen. It's updated. That is gone. Many of us may have old computers. Does it work now if it is 20, 25 years old? Not really. Go get a new one, they say. If you go to repair it, go get a new one. It won't even support the new software updates. So this is the difference between transcendental knowledge and mundane knowledge. So tell me, my dear friends, if we become a PhD, double PhD, triple PhD, quadruple PhD in Jada Gyan from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, we get PhD in Jada Gyan, mundane knowledge, from Harvard University, from Emory University, from any university, Stanford University. We get an MBA, we get an MS, we get a PhD, we get an MD. Any degree we get in Jada Gyan, in mundane knowledge, is that more valuable? Something that will not hold true few years down the road? Or is it more valuable to get Divya Gyan, which will permanently solve all our problems? Tell me, why do we have traffic laws? Why do we have the constitution of a country? Why do we have military? Why do we have hospitals and doctors and nurses and physical therapists and occupational therapists and speech therapists and pharmacists? Why do we have lawyers and attorneys? Why do we have judges? So that everyone can eat, sleep, mate, and survive peacefully. That's all. आहार निद्रा भय मैथुन, आहार निद्रा भय मैथुनमश्च समानमेतत् पशुभिर नराणा धर्मो हि तेषाम अधिको विशेषो धर्मेण हीना पशुभिर समाना। ईटिंग स्लीपिंग मेटिंग एंड डिफेंडिंग आहार निद्रा भय मैथुन समानमेतत् पशुभिर नराणा। इन पशु एंड इन नर, इन एनिमल्स एंड इन ह्यूमन बींग्स इट इज द सेम। ईटिंग स्लीपिंग मेटिंग एंड डिफेंडिंग is the same in animal species and in the human species. We may have a 6-bedroom, 6-bathroom, 4-car garage with a big front yard, backyard, a 5-cars house. We may have servants at our beck and call. We may have lots of money in our bank. We may have everything invested very safely and securely, the best health insurance, and we may be in the best of health. Hare Krishna. But is that going to last forever? Is that permanent? For example, who was the head of Apple?
Steve Jobs.
Very intelligent person, Steve Jobs. Entrepreneur, very, very smart and very successful. He created the iPhones. He had a lot of money. He was a multimillionaire. He was popular. He was respected by everyone. He had a great job. He had a loving family. He had everything that anyone could aspire for. He was living the dream. Hare Krishna. Sometimes we ask in the hospitals, hey, how are you doing? Living the dream, man. You know, that's what they say. Or can't complain. Those are the most common answers I get when I talk to my colleagues. He was living the dream. But then, unfortunately, he got pancreatic cancer. And he had the best medical technology in the most medically advanced country in the world, the United States of America, the best doctors, best hospitals, latest research, everything available. But what to do? It is Jada Gyan. It is not perfect. Science, medical technology is not perfect. He was treated, he was told that he's cured. And then it came back and took his life in a very short time. So this happens all the time. I just gave a famous example, but this happens all the time. So eating, sleeping, mating, defending is same in human beings as well as in animals. We eat, we sleep, we mate, we defend, we live in a nice, comfortable house. We try at least to do that. But even the animals are doing it in their own way. They build their nest. A tiger will have his den. A squirrel will have its burrow. They have their house. They also fetch food. They also eat. They also enjoy sex life. And they also defend themselves against predators to the best of their ability. So are we. A terrorist comes and starts attacking aggressive country comes and attacks, we try to defend ourselves. Robbers, burglars, we try to have home security system. We have latches on our doors and we lock and we may sleep with a pistol next to us. We try to defend ourselves. Even the animals do. We may have a handgun or a shotgun and they have their claws and their canine teeth to defend, or they have their agility and speed to get away from predators. So this eating, sleeping, mating, and defending is common in humans as well as the animals. Ahara nidra bhayamaitu namscha samanametat pashubhir narana. Saman, it is same. Animals and humans. So what is different between animals and us? Dharmo hitesham adhiko vishesho. It is dharma. It is practice of dharma. It is practice of transcendental knowledge that differentiates us from animals. Dharmo hi tesham adhiko vishesh. Adhik vishesh. What is extra and special in human beings? It is transcendental knowledge. It is practice of dharma. Dharmo hi tesham adhiko vishesho. All right. What if I'm not interested in your transcendental knowledge? What if I'm not interested in following dharma? I'm agnostic. I'm atheistic. I'm a materialistic person. You are living in a material world. And I'm a material girl, someone sang very famously. So what if you are a materialist? What if you are an atheist or an agnostic? धर्मो हितेषाम अधिको विशेषो धर्मेण हीना पशुभिर समाना देन यू आर पशुभिर समाना देन यू आर एज गुड एज एन एनिमल दे आर फोर लेगेड एनिमल्स यू आर टू लेगेड एनिमल्स दैट्स द ओनली डिफरेंस हरे कृष्ण धर्मेण हीना विदाउट धर्म पशुभिर समाना यू आर लाइक एन एनिमल आवर शास्त्रस आर डिक्लेयरिंग आहार निद्रा भयमैथुनंश्च समानमेतत् पशुभिर नराणा धर्मो हितेषाम अधिको विशेषो धर्मेण हीना पशुभिर समाना वेदर वी आर अ मिलियनेयर और अ बिलियनेयर वेदर वी आर कनेडियन और अमेरिकन और इंडियन और अरब और ऑस्ट्रेलियन डजंट मैटर और वेदर वी आर अ स्क्विरल और एन एंट और अ स्पाइडर मेकिंग इट्स होम इन द फॉर्म ऑफ अ वेब procuring its food in the form of trapped insects. The activity is exactly the same. Ahar nidra bhayamay. So tell me, my dear friends, jada vidya, mundane knowledge is more important that deals with how to facilitate eating, sleeping, mating, defending, or divine knowledge, transcendental knowledge, divya gyan is more important, which helps us attain a life where everything is perfect. Our desires are perfect, our love is perfect, our relationships are perfect, our physical bodies are perfect, spiritual body in a spiritual world. What is better? Transcendental knowledge is better. Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Sri Bihad Bhagavatamrita, Nectar of Devotion, Nectar of Instruction. These books are teaching us divine knowledge. So let us dive into today's verse, my dear friends. In this chapter, Krishna is telling Arjun that this transcendental knowledge or Divya Gyan was spoken to him, to the sun god at the beginning of creation. And now it is being spoken 5,000 years ago again to his dear friend Arjun, because Arjun is non-envious and he's a devotee of Krishna. That is the qualification to receive transcendental knowledge. If we want to receive the inheritance of our parents, then we have to be good children. If we try to attack our own parents, if we try to steal from them, if we break the laws repeatedly, we are repeat offenders, then we will not get anything. Even if the parents want to give, we will not be able to receive because we will be incarcerated. We will be in jail if we are doing illegal things. So similarly, if we are breaking the laws created by God Almighty, if you are breaking the laws of Bhagavad Gita or Srimad Bhagavatam, then even though we belong to Krishna, Jivera Swarupai Krishna Ranitya Das, it is our constitutional position to be Krishna's servants. Mamaya Amsha, Jiva Loka, Jiva Bhuta, Sanatana. Sanatana, eternally we are Krishna's. We belong to Krishna. We belong to God. Nothing can change that. But still, if we are disobedient, if we break the laws, we will not be able to receive Krishna's mercy. Because we will be imprisoned, we will be incarcerated by the laws of karma. Hare Krishna. So Krishna says, this divine knowledge has been given to you, my dear Arjuna, because you are my friend, you are non-envious, and you are my devotee. Bhaktosi me sakha cheti. This divine knowledge is perfect knowledge, and it is received by the Rajarshis, those who are very pious people. And it is passed down in parampara. Just like mundane knowledge also, we have to learn it from another teacher. We have to go to a university to get a degree or a diploma. Right? We need to learn. Just now, Pitambar Prabhu introduced that I am a medical doctor trained at Emory University. So as soon as we know that this person is from a bona fide university, we accept. And the patients will look it up online. All right. And they will come and see the doctor. Because they know that the doctor is from a bona fide medical university. Not only that, the physician is also board certified by the American Board of Family Medicine or Internal Medicine or Cardiology. Okay. That means he has learned from another cardiologist, who in turn has learned from another cardiologist. So the parampara exists even in mundane knowledge. How much more it is important? How much more this parampara chain is important? Disciplic succession is important in spiritual knowledge. Very, very important. Because ascending knowledge, you can go into uncharted territory and get a PhD in a unique field. But descending knowledge, It is coming from someone who has already realized it and experienced it. So it is Acharya to Acharya to Acharya. Pure devotee to pure devotee to pure devotee to pure. It's descending in a chain of perfect teachers. If one teacher is not a pure devotee, the chain is broken. Then Krishna has to start again. So we are very fortunate to be students of His Divine Grace, Abhay Charana Arvinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada, who is himself a pure devotee and comes in a line of pure devotees and has created pure devotees. Srila Prabhupada created pure devotees, so many of them. Actually, Srimad Gaur Govinda Swami Maharaj, Sri Padayendra Prabhu, Srila Bhakti Tirtha Swami Maharaj, Har Grace Ladini Mataji, Jamuna Mataji, many, many of them. So we are very fortunate. In the recent times, His Holiness Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj, so many moons he created, Srila Prabhupada. That is parampara. So Krishna explains this knowledge comes in parampara, my dear Arjun. Anyone who understands this transcendental knowledge does not take birth again in this material world, but comes back to me. And I come repeatedly in every yuga to teach this knowledge. Because time is not linear, time is cyclical. In our material world, we are taught time is linear. But the Vedic system teaches us that time is not linear, time is cyclical. There is a Divya Yuga cycle. Divya Yuga consists of four yugas: Satya, Treta Yuga, Dwapar Yuga, and Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga is 432,000 years long. Dwapar Yuga is twice that. Treta Yuga is thrice that. And Satya Yuga is four times Kali Yuga. So this four yugas combined is one Divya Yuga. So it goes on in cycles. In one day of Lord Brahma, there are 1,000 such Divya Yugas. Hare Krishna. And there are 14 Manus. Each Manu lasts for 71 Divya Yugas. 14 times 71 is 1,000 approximately. There are 1,000 Divya Yuga cycles in one day of Brahma. And that is the duration of his night. And in this way, there are 360 days in 1 year of Brahma. Such days. And Brahmaji lives for 100 years. Hare Krishna. And there is one Brahma for each Brahmanda, each material universe. So Krishna explains Kal. He explains the law of nature that we have to do a karma. If we perform vikarma, a karma is Krishna karma. Activity is meant to please Krishna. Sam Siddhir Hari Toshanam. They liberate us from this world and take us back home, back to God. But if we perform vikarma means activities that are Shastra Viruddha, that are against the Vedic scriptures. They entangle us. So then, after explaining all this, then Krishna is continuing verse number 20. So let's come to verse number 20 of the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita. Lord Krishna is telling Arjun, Tyaktva karma phala sangam nitya tripto nirashrayah karmani abhipravrittopi naiva kinchit karoti saha. Tyaktva, having given up, karma phala asangam, attachment for fruitive results, nitya, always, triptaha, being satisfied, nirashrayaha, without any shelter, karmani, in activity, abhipravrittaha, being fully engaged, api, in spite of, na, does not, eva, certainly, kinchit, anything, karoti, do, saha. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Abhay Charana Arvinda Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada. Translation. Abandoning all attachment to the results of his activities, ever satisfied and independent, he performs no fruitive action, although engaged in all kinds of undertakings. So here, Lord Krishna is describing the activities of a human being who is under the influence of transcendental knowledge. A person who is infused with transcendental knowledge. How does such a person act? That is described here. Tyaktva karma phala sangam. Tyaktva means to give up. Karma phala sangam. Phala. Karma phala means the results that we get for our actions. I work 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, for 2 weeks. on a Friday, every other Friday, I must get my paycheck. This is fruitive activity. Karma phala. And sangam means attachment. Sangha means to get attached. So Krishna is saying, tyaktva karma phala sangam, giving up attachment to the results of our activities, to the fruits of our activities, giving up attachment to the results. Nitya tripto, always being tripta, santosh, satisfaction. Satisfaction is a very important virtue, my dear friends. It is said by one very great philosopher and thinker, if the vast unlimited sky were paper, if all the innumerable trees on this planet were pens, and the vast limitless ocean were filled with ink, still the ink, the pens, and the paper, ocean water, trees, and the sky, would not be sufficient to write down the incessant material desires of one person. Hare Krishna. Let's process that. This is the truth. Mahatma Gandhiji said, there is enough in this world for everyone's need, but there is not enough in this world for one person's greed. You see? Satisfaction. Very, very important. We make our honest effort according to our abilities, and whatever comes naturally of its own accord, we should learn to be satisfied with that. I have got a 2-bedroom apartment. Now I want a 3-bedroom apartment. Now I want a 4-bedroom townhouse. Oh, now I want to live the American dream. I don't want a townhouse. I want an independent home, 5-bedroom home. Then I want a 6-bedroom house. Then I want so much salary. Then so much salary. There are people who do financial planning and they say, after retirement, our expenses are going to increase. Hare Krishna. Because they have a bucket list. Things they want to do before they die. I want to go to that Alaskan cruise. I want to do this. I want to do that. I want to go to Greece. I want to go to Australia before I die. They have a bucket list. I want to do skydiving, bungee jumping. They have a bucket list. So many material desires. And they save for retirement in such a way that their expenses per month will be more in retirement than they were before retirement. Why? Because now we want to just enjoy life. We have worked hard. Now we are 60. Now we want to just enjoy life. This is not how a devotee thinks, my dear friends. As age progresses, as we come closer to retirement, we need to wind up our material desires. And we need to desire Krishna's service more and more. We need to desire a devotee association more and more. We need to increase our spiritual desires. I have never served Radha Krishna. After retirement, with the permission of my Gurudev, I will start worshipping Radha Krishna. I don't know how to stitch clothes for my duties. I want to learn how to stitch clothes for my duties. I'm going to learn jewelry making for Radha and Krishna. I'm going to learn how to make sandesh barfi for my Radha and Krishna. These are spiritual desires. These have to be cultivated. These have to be increased as we age. And material desires have to be given up as we age. Life has to be simplified as we age. Expenses have to be reduced as we age. Naam bhajan has to increase as we age. Hare Krishna. So these are things that we have to think about and plan. Nitya tripto. This is the meaning of nitya tripto. always satisfied. Satisfaction is a great virtue. If we are dissatisfied, we will never be happy. Dissatisfaction comes from an untrained mind. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, there are sense objects, things that we want to enjoy in this world. And then we have our senses. So, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha. We want to enjoy with our five senses. Shabda means sound vibrations with our ears. Sparsha with our skin, touching different objects. Shabda, sparsha, rupa, with our eyes, we want to see beauty, beautiful things. Shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, we want to eat tasty things. And gandha. People pay lots of money for perfumes. We want to smell different things. Shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, we want to enjoy in this material world. But nitya tripto, satisfaction is a very important quality, my dear. So we have to be satisfied with simple things. So there are all these sense objects, shabda, sparsha, rupa, rasa, gandha, and to enjoy those sense objects, we have the senses. We have eyes, nose, ears, skin, and tongue. These are the gyanendriyas, five gyanendriyas that we have. So Bhagavad Gita says, higher, more advanced than the sense objects are the senses. Senses are higher than the sense objects. Higher than the senses is the sixth sense. Manah shashthani indriyani. Sixth sense, that is mana, mind. Mind is higher than the dull senses, eyes, ears. Mind is higher. If the lights go off, eyes cannot see. Right? You put earplugs, you cannot hear properly. Or you get old, you cannot hear properly. Or you have a sore throat, you cannot speak. You have COVID-19, you cannot smell anosmia. You cannot taste food. So senses are dull, but mind is always active. You see, mind is always, so mind is superior to the senses. But higher than the mind is the ability to discern between right and wrong. And that is faculty of the intelligence. So intelligence is higher than the mind. And higher than the mind and intelligence is the soul. And the Lord of the soul is the super soul, Krishna. This is the spiritual hierarchy. Satisfaction comes from an untrained mind. Who is higher than the mind? Intelligence. How do we nourish and strengthen our intelligence? Shastra Swadhyay. Shastra Swadhyay. By studying the scriptures, by hearing Acharya Vani, by hearing the words of the perfect Acharyas like Srila Prabhupada. That is how, by Swadhyaya and Shravan, we develop intelligence, spiritual intelligence. And with this spiritual intelligence, we have to control the mind. Satisfaction. Satisfaction. Very important. Let's look inside our heart and see. Dissatisfaction is the source of so many problems. So many complications. So much sorrow. Satisfaction, my dear friends, is very important. Dissatisfaction comes from uncontrolled mind. Mind can be trained and controlled with intelligence. And intelligence comes from Shastra Swadhyaya and Acharya Vani Shravan. Reading the holy revealed scriptures like Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, and hearing the words of Acharyas, like Bhaktivedanta Purports and lectures of Srila Prabhupada. Nitya Tripto. Nirashraya. Ashraya means shelter. Nirashraya means not depending on anyone. Depending only on Krishna. Avashya Rakshive Krishna. Krishna will protect. Having this vishwas, having this faith, that Krishna is the protector. My insurance policy is not my protector. My bank balance, my money is not my protector. My family members, my friends, my doctor, my specialist, my subspecialist is not my protector. These medicines are not my protector. My gun is not my protector. This house is not my protector. Krishna is my real protector. These are all energies of Krishna. The doctor is getting his or her intelligence from Krishna. The house is being maintained by Krishna. My heart is pumping because of Krishna's presence as Paramatma. So Krishna is the protector for everyone. This is called Nirashraya. Not taking ashraya in mundane things. Taking ashraya in Krishna. Karmani abhipravrittopi. Abhipravritta means with our full pravritti, full faculty being engaged in karma. Being engaged in activity. Api means although, even though. Naiva kinchit karoti saha. But still actually he is not doing anything. Even though he is doing so many things, such a person is not doing anything if he is completely dependent on Krishna, if he is doing it for Krishna, if he is not taking any shelter other than Krishna, if he is satisfied, and if such a person has given up attachment to the fruits of one's activities. Then even though such a person is working as a doctor, engineer, pharmacist, MBA, entrepreneur, whatever, such a person is not doing any vikarma. Such a person is not doing any mundane karmic activity. Such a person is acting on a transcendental plane. Hare Krishna. That is the meaning of this verse. So we should not give up our work in this world. We need to develop intelligence and understand who we are working for and why we are working. We are working for Krishna, and why we are working? To please Krishna. We are working for Krishna, and the aim of work is to please and serve Krishna. That's all. If we have this conviction, this proper understanding, and we act on this understanding, on the basis of this understanding, then we are well situated. We are situated in transcendental knowledge. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. This freedom from the bondage of actions is possible only in Krishna consciousness. When one is doing everything for Krishna, what is Krishna consciousness? Srila Prabhupada just defined it for us in the first line of the purport. Srila Prabhupada says, what is Krishna consciousness? Krishna consciousness is when one is doing everything for Krishna. Tvameva mata chapita tvameva bandhu matsakha tvameva vidya dravinam tvameva sarvam mama deva deva. Oh Krishna, you are the Lord of all the devatas. Deva Deva. Krishna, you are everything for me. You are my sarvasva. That is the meaning of Krishna consciousness. Working for Krishna is Krishna consciousness. Thinking of Krishna is Krishna consciousness. Wanting to serve and please Krishna is Krishna consciousness. If we are asked, what is this Krishna consciousness? International Society for Krishna Consciousness. Here is the paribhasha. Here is the definition. Krishna consciousness is when one is doing everything for Krishna. Yat karoshi yad ashnashi yad juhosi dadasi yat tapasyasi kaunteya tat kurushva mad arpanam. Whatever we do, whatever we eat, whatever work we do, whatever charity we give, we do everything for the pleasure of Krishna. Keeping Krishna in the center. That is Krishna consciousness. A Krishna conscious person acts out of pure love for the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. And therefore, he or she has no attraction for the results of the action. Attraction for the results of our actions will be there if we know I'm doing it for myself. With this money, I'm going to drink wine, the most expensive wine. With this money, I will go to the most expensive 5-star restaurant. Then we are attached. But if we understand that all wealth belongs to Krishna, Voktaram Yagya Tapasam Sarvaloka Maheshwaram Suridam Sarvabhutanam Nyatva Mam Shanti Mrichati. Getting real Shanti, real peace formula is to understand that Krishna is the proprietor of everything. Krishna is always in control. Krishna is always in control, no matter what is happening in this world. Who is attacking whom, what war, the stock market going up and down, whatever epidemic, pandemic, whatever is happening in this world, my dear friends, Krishna is always very happy. Divya Vrindaranya Kalpa Dhrumada Srimad Ratna Gara Simha Sanasthau Srimad Radha Srila Govinda Devau Preshthali Bhise Vyamanau Smarami. Even if this whole world is exploding and burning and getting annihilated, there is a tornado, there is a hurricane, tsunami, atomic bombs going off, war, pestilence, pandemic, no matter what is going on in this world, Krishna in the spiritual world, eternally, Divya Vrindaranya Dhuman, Kalpavruksha Dhuman. Adha means under. Under a beautiful Kalpavruksha, desire fulfilling tree, in a divine forest, Divyad Vrindaranya. In Vrindavan, in a divine Aranya means forest, divine forest, under a Kalpavruksha tree, Srimad Radha, Srila Govinda Devo, Radha and Govinda, Radha and Krishna, Preshthalibhi Sevyamana. They are being served by Preshthalibhi, by their Priya Sakhis, by the Priya Gopis, by loving maid servants. Radha and Krishna are eternally being served in the beautiful spiritual world of Goloka Vrindavan, in the beautiful forests, under a beautiful desire tree. Divyat Vrindaranya Kalpadrumada Srimad Ratna Gara Simhasanastha, on a beautiful Simhasan, on a beautiful throne. Srimad Radha Srila Govinda Devo Preshthalibhi Sevyamano Smara. They are being served by the Ashtasakhis and Manjaris in Goloka Vrindavan, no matter what happens in this world. So if we are doing everything for Krishna, knowing that Krishna is always in control, Krishna is always perfect and Krishna is always happy. Sat Chit Ananda Vigraha. Krishna's form is made up of eternality, knowledge, and pure spiritual bliss. Nothing can disturb Radha and Krishna's enjoyment. And we are their servants, servants of their servants, and we are doing everything for them. If we have this meditation, if we have this understanding, nothing in this world can disturb us. Hare Krishna. And we will have no attraction for the fruits of all. So we are doing it for Krishna. Even if the money is stolen, it has gone to Krishna. Everything is within Krishna. Yomam paschati sarvatra. Sarvam chamai paschati. Tasyaham na pranashyami. Sacham yena pranashyati. One who sees me everywhere and everything in me, for him I am never lost, nor is he ever lost. So if you are Krishna conscious, we are not attached to our fruits. We get attached when we have selfish motives. Hare Krishna. A devotee is not even attached to his personal maintenance, for everything is left to Krishna. Nor is he anxious to secure things, nor to protect things already in his possessions. He does his duty to the best of his ability and leaves everything to Krishna. We have to do our duty to the best of our ability and then leave everything to Krishna. Mare Krishna rakhe ke, rakhe Krishna mare ke. If Krishna wants to protect, no one can destroy. If Krishna wants to finish something, no one can save. Hare Krishna. Such an unattached person is always free from the resultant reactions of good and bad. It is as though he were not doing anything. This is a sign of akarma, or actions without fruitive reactions. Every action has equal and opposite reaction. But if we engage in akarma, which is Krishna karma, Krishna conscious activities, then there is no reaction. Akarma. Any other action, therefore, devoid of Krishna consciousness, is binding upon the worker. And that is the real aspect of vikarma, as explained herein before. Vikarma means activities that bind us. Akarma means activities that take us closer to Krishna. Aim of life is to engage in akarma and to give up vikarma. End of purport. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Southville, Canada, devotees ki jai. Hare Krishna. Thank you very much. I will stop here.
Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thank you so much, Adi Gadadhar Das Prabhuji, for the wonderful class. We really appreciate you dedicating your time and efforts. I know you are keeping busy, but you still were gracious enough to allocate your time, and we appreciate that. So, Prabhu, just in 2 minutes, if you allow me, I can summarize the class. I was jotting down some few points. Is it okay, Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, please.
Thank you, Prabhu. So, Prabhu, first...
Oh, sorry, sorry. Prabhu, you'll have to unmute. I just changed the settings so the devotee can unmute. You'll have to unmute yourself.
Yes, Prabhu.
Sorry, please go ahead. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. So, Prabhu, you said in the beginning of the class that knowledge is of two types, Jada Jnana, which is temporary material knowledge, and Divya Jnana, which is transcendental knowledge. So, Jada Jnana is mundane and ascending knowledge, which is based on experiments. We can make it better, but we cannot make it perfect knowledge. Whereas Divya Jnana is descending process, and the perfect source gives perfect knowledge, you know, in the disciplic succession, acharyas, in our authorized sampradayas. So again, you said eating, sleeping, mating, defending is common between animals and human beings. But it is dharma or the transcendental knowledge which differentiates human beings from animals. So without dharma, human beings are just two-legged animals. And one more point is, as our age progresses, we need to wind down our material desires. We need to increase our devotional services or spiritual desires. Nama bhajan must increase as we age. And then the last point, which is worth noting down, is dissatisfaction comes from an untrained mind. So if our mind is trained with the transcendental knowledge, Prabhu, then everything falls in place. Then we will be trupta, you know, we will be satisfied perfectly and independent. Thank you so much, Prabhu, for that one. With that, we open the forum for any questions, comments, and then Prabhu will be more than happy to answer. You can unmute yourself, devotees. I think you are able to unmute yourself now and ask questions.
If there are no questions, Prabhu, then we can...
Sure, Prabhu. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Prabhu, I have a question. So in this world, like we have seen, like you explained this theory of karma, akarma, and vikarma, but we see so many people are doing so much vikarma, still we see them flourishing. And sometimes mind gets disturbed that even though they are doing so many nasty things like drinking and meat eating, still they are doing very well-to-do family. And sometimes they are very good, like in sharing the material knowledge. So Prabhu, how do we understand that?
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Manish Prabhu, for this very important question. As previously explained in this very chapter of Bhagavad Gita, we read verse number 20th. The preceding 2-3 verses explain kim karmeti kim akarmeti kavayo api muhyate. What is action, what is inaction, what is karma, what is how the law of karma works. Even the intelligent people are bewildered. You remember that verse? Even the intelligent people are bewildered. So, for us, being conditioned souls, it is very difficult to understand what is the karmic background of which person. Because we are also individual souls. Only Paramatma knows what is the background of which person. Only the Paramatma knows. We don't know. For example, it is said that Dhritarashtra Maharaj, he had killed 100 small newborn birds. And therefore, as a reaction, his 100 sons had to die. Now, nobody knew this. So we don't know what we have done in our previous life. We have gone through millions of births in this material world, Manish Prabhu, millions of births. And we have karma accumulated from all those births. If someone is flourishing right now, It is because the pious activities from the previous life are being utilized. We have a debit card of pious activities, and we can swipe that debit card and enjoy in this world. But then we also have debt. We have a credit card debt. And what is that debt that we have to repay? All our bad activities, sinful activities, vikarma. This is the law of karma. So if someone is enjoying, things are going well in someone's life, that means that person is using the pious activity debit card. As long as there is balance in that pious activity debit card, that person can go on. While the person is going on, the person has a choice whether the person can do pious activities or impious activities. If the person does impious activities, once the good karma debit card is over, then he has to sit and repay the huge credit debt that he has of vikarma, of bad karma. And then one goes to hell to suffer after being beaten and punished in the hellish planet, as described in the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Then what happens? Every time you are beaten, every time you suffer, your credit is, your loan, your debt that you owe is decreasing. You are becoming debt free. Every time we suffer, every time we fall down, every time we have difficulties and we go through troubles and sufferings, our vikarma is getting exhausted. We are getting purified. You see? So both the things are going on birth after birth. What we are seeing is a photograph. But what Krishna is seeing as Paramatma is the full movie. It is very difficult to judge by seeing still photographs from the movie. If there is a 1.5 hour movie, Manish Prabhu, and I give you 5 pictures, still pictures from that movie, and I tell you, Manish Prabhu, please tell me the whole story. Will you be able to tell? You can unmute and answer, Manish Prabhu. Will you be able to tell based on those 5 photographs what has happened? So what we are seeing, Manish Prabhu, in this lifetime, in few years, that is like a photograph. That soul has been going through different bodies, accruing different karma for millions of births. So how can we judge what the person is doing in 5 years and 10 years and 20 years? It's like a photograph. So yes, we can see some activities that are going on now, but the person has so much, like a mountain of karmic, good and bad karmic reaction. And they come and go, come and go. Sometimes we are paying the loan, repaying the loan. Sometimes we are spending the money that we have earned, spending the pious credits that we have earned by enjoying in this world. So generally, before the loan repayment program is started by Yamaraj, what happens is, if one is very pious, please pay attention, Manish Prabhu, this is very important. If one is pious, it is very difficult for Yamaraj to punish that person in hell because there is a lot of piety. You see, if someone has good money in the saving account, then it is very difficult for the government, even though he may have some debts, to make that person file for bankruptcy. Why should that person file for bankruptcy? He has got money in the saving account. He can use that to repay the loan. So as long as one has pious credits, the person may not go to hell to get full-fledged punishment for all the vikarma, bad karma that one has done. So therefore, Yamaraj allows the person to enjoy in this material. Enjoy, enjoy, enjoy. Whatever pious credits you have, you exhaust them. Finish your prepaid debit card. When your debit card balance will be zero, then you come to me. And then I will get all the loan repayment from you. Then the person goes to hell to suffer. So therefore, we see that bad things may happen apparently to good people, and good things may happen to bad people because we are looking at photographs. But the law of karma is very perfect. It is mentioned in our scriptures, and there are so many stories in the Puranic literature that show how this law of karma is very perfect. Yamaraj ji is a supreme judge, and he is very perfect. He is empowered by Krishna to administer justice. So we cannot judge based on few years of activities of a person. Is that okay, Manish Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhu. Yes, very, very pleasing, Prabhu. Very pleasing for mine. Otherwise, like, yeah, it's. I will also like maybe reflect on that your answer and maybe get convinced.
Hare Krishna. Thank you. Very pleasing to the mind. Your name is Manish. Manish can be Krishna, who is Rishikesh, the master of all the senses, and mind is one of the senses. Manish can also mean intelligence, because as we discussed, intelligence is the controller of the mind. So very good. I'm happy.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. Jai Shila Prabhupada. Is there
thank
anyone
you so
else?
Much. Thank you so much, Prabhu. There is a question in the chat box. I will just read out to you. The question says, how do we discern whether one is being lazy or selfless? Like in your example, that if something is stolen, then one thinks it is all Krishna's anyway, you know.
So we also read in the purport, Ladini Gopika Mataji, we also read in the purport that Prabhupada said we have to do our best. We have to put in our best effort and leave the rest to Krishna. So if something is stolen, first of all, we have to practice due diligence to prevent a theft from happening, because a theft could be a result of carelessness. But we should be careful. And if it is lost, we should make a sincere effort to find it. But still, if we are not able to find it, then what this verse and purport is teaching us is we don't get completely disturbed and preoccupied by the loss, knowing that ultimately Krishna is everywhere, everything belongs to Krishna, and nobody can steal anything from Krishna, you see. But as we are engaged in certain service, maintaining a household or maintaining a temple or maintaining this body, we should practice due diligence. And if something is stolen, we should make an effort to find it sincerely. And if we don't find it, we should not get completely disturbed. I cannot chant my rounds because I have lost such a precious thing. No, that should not happen. These things should not affect our bhajan. Not getting affected means it should not affect our bhajan. When Abhimanyu was killed, Arjun cried. Subhadra Devi cried. But what was the effect? Arjun's bhajan increased. Arjun vowed, I will kill Jayadrath, who was the root cause of Abhimanyu's death, unjust, unfair death. It was Jayadrath who did not allow Bhimsen and Yudhishthir and Nakul and Sahadeva to reach my dear son Abhimanyu. Therefore, I vow, Jayadrath will not be able to see Suryasta tomorrow. He will not be able to see the sunset tomorrow. Before sunset, I will kill him. And to fulfill that vow, Krishna asked him, Arjun, do you realize Karna is still alive? Dronacharya is still alive. Kripacharya is still alive. Dushasan is alive. Duryodhan is alive. These are all Maharathis. They are going to put their best effort to protect that Jayadrath. How will you kill him before sunset tomorrow? Arjun looked at Krishna and said, I made this vow having faith in your power, Arjun. Your power, Krishna. You are there. Why should I worry? So although his son died, Arjun's bhajan, Arjun's faith in Krishna, love for Krishna, and Arjun's determination to fight, because Krishna wanted him to fight, increased. So when difficulties come, our bhajan, our love for Krishna, our dedication and devotion to Krishna should increase. Laziness is when difficulties come and our bhajan takes a hit. That is bad. In happy times, we increase our bhajan, because we have all the facilities available to intensify our bhajan. And when difficulties come, in a mood of helplessness, we further intensify our bhajan, which means our bhajan has to intensify every moment. That is the meaning of Krishna consciousness. We have to try our best and leave the rest to Krishna. And try our best means to try to find things that we have lost. Due diligence. Try our best. But if we cannot find it, we don't get all worked up. We don't start blaming Krishna. What are you doing, Krishna? You could not even protect my belongings. Not like that. We understand. Law of karma. Tattenu kampam susamikshamanu gunjana evatma kripam dhudakam ridvak vapur bhindu dhan namaste jivetayo mukti padesana. Is that okay? Ladini Gopika Mataji?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. I was thinking on that answer, Prabhu, that, you know, I would say attachment is the cause of all miseries. So if we don't have attachment in the very first place, attachment means, you know, overly concerned about the possessions. If we don't have that attachment, then when we lose it, we don't lament as much. If you can throw some more light on that, Prabhu.
Yes, mundane attachments are the source of all problems. That's why the first word of this verse was nirasakta, not being asakta, not being attached. In the first line of this verse, it was mentioned by Krishna. But what is the antidote? What is the treatment for mundane attachment? It is attachment. Attachment to Krishna. Attachment to devotees. Attachment to devotional service. So those positive attachments have to be developed so that these lower attachments can be given up. Rasopyaham rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehinam rasopyam rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. We can give up the lower taste, lower attachments by developing higher attachments. Attachment to Krishna, who is the most beautiful, who is the most wonderful. Krishna is the most attractive. Krishna is most faithful, most dependable. Krishna is the best master, best lover. And Srimati Radharani is the source of all love. If we get attached to the lotus feet of Srimati Radharani and Sri Krishna, then we will be saved from these lower attachments. Is that okay, Pitambar Prabhu? You are right.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. That was wonderful. Attachment to Krishna would automatically detach us from the material attachments. Thank you so much. So, devotees, any other questions, you can please unmute and ask Prabhu if there are any questions.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Swaminathan, Prabhu.
Wonderful explanations, Prabhuji. I would like to listen more from you like this, Prabhuji. And I would like to expand the same question what was asked previously about detachment. When we are in detachment from the material desires, will it be, are we able to improve our material upliftment? Like, are we still putting effort to get the material upliftment or no?
Yes, we are. But the definition of material upliftment changes when we become sincere devotees in Krishna consciousness. We may no longer have the desire to become a millionaire. Or we may no longer have the desire to work 12 and 14 hours in a day. We may not have that taste. It's a fact. When we become sincere devotees, that taste, that passion for the rat race decreases. We become more sattvic and we become more peaceful and we are more situated in the mode of goodness. And therefore, we like to live a simple life. We are diligent, we are ethical, and we are hardworking. But as we see in the modern times, sometimes people are so workaholic. They work, they hardly sleep. They work or do things related to their mundane work all the time to get ahead in the rat race. That is very difficult for a devotee. That is very difficult for a devotee, for a genuine devotee of Krishna. But we work. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, 8 hours for the world, 8 hours a day we can work. 8 hours for ourselves. Because we sleep for 6 hours. We may eat 2 meals in a day, half an hour, that's 1 hour. And then bathing, brushing our teeth, exercising, that takes another 1 hour. Maintaining our body. So 8 hours for ourselves, 8 hours for the world. And 8 hours for bhajan with the family. 8 hours for Krishna bhajan with our family members, which means doing deity worship, doing arati, kirtan, naam bhajan, reading scriptures together, the whole family coming together and reading Chaitanya Charitamrita, for example. Aha. So there are 24 hours in a day. 8 hours for ourselves, 8 hours for bhajan with the family members, and 8 hours for the world. Job. This is how a devotee likes to live, but not Ugra Karma. Not Ugra Karma. With all due respect, one, I have not read, I don't watch news or anything, but one devotee was telling me that, who is the chief of that electric company, electric car company, Tesla?
Elon Musk.
So I have heard that he works very hard, like 16 hours a day. He sleeps in the office. Of course, he has many offices and very rich person also, multimillionaire, very successful. So yes, materially, he is very accomplished. But again, it is all under the umbrella of eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So that is not the purpose of life. Purpose of life is not to become the owner of Tesla company, manufacture cars, and go to the moon or whatever else we are doing. That is not the aim of life. That is Ugra Karma, working too hard, foaming at the mouth like a donkey just to get a carrot. That is not the purpose of life, because this carrot doesn't really satisfy. The carrot can satisfy for a few hours, but then again there will be hunger. Again there will be Trishna. The hunger in the material world is called Trishna. Trishna, hunger, thirst for sense gratification. For example, someone may feel that I have to gratify my senses by eating in a five-star restaurant. I have read such wonderful reviews. Oh, that is not Krishna Prasad. So one may go, one may eat. The ambience will be very good. The waiter, the service will be fantastic. The food may be very delicious, very tasty. And we may have a very satisfying meal. Aha, it was so nice. Five-star. We may go to Google and then give a five-star review to that restaurant also. But then what happens next morning? We are again hungry. There is no real satisfaction. We are again hungry. So there is no end to sense gratification. It is not sustainable sense gratification. I repeat, sense gratification cannot be sustainable. It cannot be sustainable. There will be impediments, there will be frustration, there will be hankering and lamentation. But spiritual sense gratification is always perfect and sustainable. It is self-sustaining. नेहा विक्रमनाशोस्ति प्रत्यवायोन विद्यते स्वल्पमप्यस्य धर्मस्य त्रायते महतो भय. There is no loss or diminution on this path of pure devotional service. Second chapter, Krishna says. So, I don't know, I forgot what was your question. I was just saying. I hope it did it address for you.
No, yes, Prabhuji. Actually, you were explaining what I was asking. And I was also thinking in my mind, like when you were comparing Elon Musk, who puts more work to for his upliftment, is like Ugra or something.
Ugra Karma.
Ugra Karma.
Excessive hard work.
Yes, Prabhuji. But what I'm also thinking, should we put any effort for our upliftment, or we should be happy with our present condition?
We need a mentor or a Shiksha Guru or our Diksha Guru, if Diksha Guru is available, or some spiritual counselor or mentor to help us individualize and personalize our life, spiritual life. Because these are very personal questions, but it depends on the situation. Arjun put in a lot of hard work as an archer. He became Gudakesh. He gave up his sleep and he was practicing even in the dark. He went to the heavenly planets and received divine celestial weapons from Indradev and others. For what? To utilize it in the service of Krishna. Because one of the purposes of Krishna's advent, as mentioned earlier in the same fourth chapter, is Vinashaya cha dushkrita, to kill the miscreant, destroy the miscreants. And nimitta matra bhava savya sachi. And Krishna wanted to use Arjuna as his nimitta matra, as his instrument in accomplishing destruction of the demons. And therefore, Krishna employed Arjun to kill the Kaurava army, to kill Karna, to kill Jayadrath and others. He employed Bhimasen to kill 100 sons of Dhritarashtra. Bhimasen alone killed all the 100 sons of Dhritarashtra, headed by Duryodhan and Dushasan. So they are working for Krishna. They are doing Krishna karma. So in the service of Krishna, one should try to be best. One should try to be one's very best self. We are not necessarily competing with others. Arjun was not really competing with others. That I will create some impediment in Karna's practice of archery because I'm envious of him. You don't have to become envious. But we have to compete with ourselves. We should be the best we can be based on what potential Krishna has given us. Potentially, we want to be the best. We have to be the best in our field, whether we are MBA, whether we are engineers, doctors, lawyers, whoever we are, businessmen. We have to be the best that we can. But that doesn't mean that we give up our bhajan and we start working 16 hours a day. We have to balance. And how exactly to balance? For that, we need a shiksha guru. We need a spiritual mentor in our life who can guide us.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Jai Shila Prabhupada.
Jai.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. Devotees, any other questions? Okay. Thank you so much, Adi Gadadharas Prabhu. It was wonderful to hear from you. At the same time, we wish and pray that you continue sharing your spiritual wisdom with Stoil Krishna community, Prabhu. This is of great value to us, and we really appreciate your valuable association. Thank you, everyone, for attending. Hare Krishna. Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyeva.